So I just published a book, which I'll talk about in just a second. And what I wanted to do tonight was essentially kind of go over the findings of the book, some of the questions I asked, some of the answers I moved towards, and then essentially have question and answer and kind of address any issues that folks want to raise and talk about them in the context of one of the most, I think, pernicious questions of the Middle Ages, which is the relationship of Christianity to violence and warfare. Specifically for my research, in terms of how it worked with churchmen, the clergy, you know, the guys who were anointed to be the ministers of Christ in Europe. Okay, a little bit about myself. I started my academic career up in Massachusetts, which is where I'm from. So I did a bachelor's degree in government and one in history at Western New England University. I then went over to England and did a master's degree in medieval history with the University of Durham. And then I came back and did my PhD in history up at the University of Rochester. Prior to coming here, I worked as a part-time professor at Syracuse while I was doing my PhD, which was a lot of fun because they have basketball and students too. I'm mostly interested in basketball, I guess. I then did a one-year stint at Southeast Missouri State over in Cape Girardeau, Missouri. And from there, I came down here as an assistant professor. And then this year, for reasons passing understanding, they decided to tenure and promote me. So I guess I'll be here for a bit longer, and I'm now an associate professor of history here at A&M. All right, so warrior churchmen of medieval England, 1000 to 1250. The dates are obviously a little bit fungible, I suppose. Available from Boydell and Brewer, my publisher, also available from Amazon, and Raynell tells me will be available in the bookstore. We were hoping today. I don't think they came in yet, so they should be there tomorrow. For those of you who do have books, I'm more than happy to sign them tonight, or I can sign them in the future after you buy them for a small fee. Okay, that was a joke. Thank you for not laughing. I appreciate that. You should laugh when I make jokes. It makes me feel better. Foster will laugh. I appreciate it. I'm going to start by just giving you the outline of the book, and then we'll get into some of the actual discussion points. So when I conceived of this project, what I essentially wanted to do was look at, as I'm a cultural historian, I'm very interested in what people think should be the case in society, and then what is actually the case in society. So the first half of the book, or the first section of the book, I call the prescriptive voices of the debate. Basically, who was telling clerics what they should be like? What sort of cultural vectors do we have where clerics could point to it and say, oh, that's how I should behave? And obviously for Christian clerics, you begin with like the New Testament, early synodal evidence, synods are like meetings of bishops and whatnot, and ecumenical councils, and then also the Peace of God movement and the Truce of God movement. We'll talk a little bit about those. I then discuss some of the papal centralization movements, the increasing power of the Pope, alongside things like the Crusades, the military orders, the Templars, whom the History Channel tell me are behind apparently pretty much everything in Western history, so that's useful, and the growth of canon law, the growing idea that there's an actual body of legislation that governs the way the church should work. And then finally I look at what I call the epic archetype, or evidence from chivalric literature. These are basically the imaginative stories that people listen to in the Middle Ages, and the ones that I focus on are primarily based around a character known as Archbishop Turpin from the Roland stories, and as Courtney's laughing because we read a lot of Roland in my classes, and also some of the stories around William, who's supposed to be the Count of Orange, and the story of him becoming a monk, which is amusing when he beats people to death with the leg of a horse, but we'll get to that later. After that, most of the book is actually looking at actual examples from England. So the first half is kind of European-wide. The second half is, let's see what actual English clerics were doing during the period that I'm particularly interested in, which is basically the High Middle Ages, so from about 1000 up to mid part of the 13th century. And I won't go through all these necessarily, but I'll do it later on. But each of these kind of aligns with basically a time period that we will then cover. So, late 11th into the early 12th century, mid 12th century, late 12th century, and then down into the 13th century. Okay. I begin the book, and I begin the talk, with one of my favorite little examples from the Middle Ages, or sayings from the Middle Ages. There was an author named William of Newburgh, who was an English historian in the late 1100s. He wrote this probably, we think, maybe in 1198, something like that. Most renowned for absolutely greetings, folks, fine to see. Absolutely hating Geoffrey of Monmouth. Geoffrey of Monmouth is the guy who basically invented the King Arthur stories. So if you start reading William of Newburgh, the first 6 or 7 pages of his history is how much of a real, utter, and complete horrible person Geoffrey of Monmouth was for inventing all of these stories. But he also talks about this one reasonably small event in Scottish history where a bishop, a fellow by the name of Wiemund, becomes the bishop of the Isle of Man. I think it is a small island off the coast of Scotland. And he gets it into his head that he should actually be an earl, that he should actually be a nobleman. So he puts together an army and he starts marauding around the countryside and basically causing real mischief for the Scottish king, David. No one ever really, well, they eventually catch him and blind him and castrate him, so it goes badly for him. But before that happens, this happens. He's basically met in battle by a fellow bishop. And for those of you who can't read the quotation, this is what it says. Whereupon, spiriting up his people, superior only in faith, for in other respects he was greatly inferior, he, the unnamed bishop, met him, Bishop Wiemund, as he was furiously advancing, and himself striking the first blow in the battle, by way of animating his party, he threw a small axe, and by God's assistance, he felled his enemy to the earth as he was marching in the van. And I always liked this story, because A, it's an amusing image, because I'm not a very nice person, apparently, and I like the thought of someone getting hit with an axe while they're basically leading a marauding Viking-like army, but also because I think it demonstrates a central truth of what this book shows. And this shouldn't come as a great shock to us. Both of these guys were doing something wrong, according to the law of the church, as we'll see in a few minutes. Both of these bishops, because they're both bishops, were marching in battle. Both of these guys were wielding weapons. Both of these guys were leading men in battle. That was bad, according to the Christian church. However, according to our author, who himself is a cleric, William of Newburgh, only one of these guys is a villain, and one of these guys is a hero, right? The guy who the villain is the one who is marauding, the one who is using violence for personal gain. He's going off pillaging and raping and burning and committing all the oldest sins in the newest ways, whereas the hero is the one who stood against him, right? The one who put himself on the line to defend his flock, the one who put himself on the line to defend his people, and even though his actions are just as canonically problematic, that's okay, because, you know, common sense, pragmatism, basically dictate that we judge things by more than just the letter of the law. And you might think that makes total sense. You'd be surprised how little we find that in the actual writings of both contemporary and modern historians who have a really hard time thinking that that's how the Middle Ages actually worked. So, what are some of the questions that I think about? One is, and these are some of the basic questions of, you know, kind of warrior clerics in the first millennia. You know, was every warrior cleric simply condemned or criticized? Obviously, the answer to that, as I just showed you, is going to be no, and we'll talk about some of the examples of that. Was there any support for active clerical embrace of violence? Was there ever a time when people thought that, yes, sometimes it was okay for clerics to pick up weapons or lead men in battle or what have you? And if so, in what circumstances and what actions? So these are some of the basic questions that I ask. When was it okay for clerics to fight? When was it okay for clerics to be generals? Now, for the clerics who are, we'll come back to this slide, for the clerics who are considering these questions, they have a few different places they can think about, they can look to for evidence, right? One of the first places they're going to try to find evidence is going to be the New Testament. So I'm going to move over here because I'm going to have to read that, so I will try to speak loudly so everybody can hear me, though I won't have my microphone. The New Testament is going to be obviously the first destination for people to think about what it means to be both a good Christian, but also a good cleric. So I just chose some of the examples that they could look to. And these are all going to be from the Gospels, and so not necessarily from Acts or the letters of Paul. The last one's going to be from Revelation. This, of course, comes from Matthew 5:38 through 40, which is essentially Christ as a peacemaker, right? And what Matthew says is, you have heard, this is Christ speaking, you have heard that it was said, eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth, but I tell you not to resist an evil person. If someone slaps you on your right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if someone wants to sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. I think for us, or for those of us who are modern day Christians, this message resonates a great deal, right? Because when most people think about the precepts of Christianity in the modern world, and Christ in particular, they see him as a very pacifistic kind of figure, right? That there is this idea that, this is the Garden of Gethsemane, we'll get to that in a second, but there's this idea that, you know, turn the other cheek, right? That's one of the central hallmark moments and ideas of Christianity, whether we can also go to the Sermon on the Mount and talk about, you know, the blessed are the meek and so forth. So there's plenty of examples in the New Testament for the idea that Christians really shouldn't be violent. And that was actually one of the first arguments in the early church. Could violent people even be Christians? I.e., if you're a soldier, could you even join the Christian church, for instance? And, you know, they eventually decide that yes, they could, but they shouldn't continue to be soldiers and so forth. So right there, you should think, oh, well, obviously clerics should probably not be violent. But like anything that man touches, it's not quite so simple as that. One of the other famous examples, right? The Garden of Gethsemane. This story is going to be used throughout the Middle Ages as an example of why clerics should not use violence, probably even more so than the turn the other cheek idea. This is the one that Gratian, one of the great canonical authors of the 12th century, uses as the example to show why clerics should not bear arms. And it's, of course, a very famous scene where Peter cuts the ear off of the servant. But let's take a look at what it says. It says, then Jesus said, this is after he slices the guy's ear off, then Jesus said to him, put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword, right? He who kills with the sword dies by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then should the scriptures be fulfilled that it must be so? For medieval authors, while this might seem to us, right, he who lives by the sword dies by the sword, or he who takes up the sword dies by the sword, it's not quite as simple a matter as it might seem. Because when they start parsing the words of Christ there, they think, seeing this idea that Peter was wrong to use violence then. Peter was wrong to use violence in that particular context. But as one of the Decretalists of the late 12th century points out, Christ tells Peter to put his sword into its place. He doesn't tell him to take it off. He doesn't tell him to cast it aside. He says, keep it, but don't use it right now. Now, again, I think as modern Christians, we kind of have a hard time with that interpretation, right? But, you know, we're not arguing with these folks. They've been dead for a long time. But for those who are looking for a little bit more ecumenical guidance, you know, this becomes a little more problematic, perhaps, than we initially thought. This is one of my favorites. This is Christ the Good Shepherd, right? One of the most famous kind of images. I looked for a very gauzy kind of image of Christ. I think I found it. He's got the lamb. It's lovely, right? But you actually read this, and at first glance, Christ the Good Shepherd would indicate this idea of being very meek and very mild, but that's if you're the sheep. This is what Christ actually says about the shepherd. This is from John. I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. As we can see later on in actually the book of St. Foix, which Courtney and I were talking about earlier, one of the clerics in it uses this and other, I dropped my microphone, sorry, uses this example to indicate that if a bishop is not willing to go defend his flock violently if necessary, he's not doing his Christian duty the way Christ told him he should. That if he is not willing to lay down his life for his flock and only thinks that his job is to protect the soul of his people, he's missing the point. And that, again, helps these clerics to kind of think of themselves as something else. And then finally, one of my favorites, this is a horrible image, but it was the 70s. This is Christ from Revelation. Now, this is a Christ that we talk about a lot in my class because it's one that I don't know that modern Christians are actually all that comfortable with. Christ from the Gospels, I think we get. Christ from Revelation on a horse with a flaming sword and all of that. That's a little tougher. And, you know, if we had more time, we could go through this. But these are all competing visions. I don't want you to give the idea that clerics who embraced violence were in the majority or anything. They really weren't. They were always kind of the minority opinion. But they weren't necessarily pariahs. They weren't necessarily so beyond the pale of the ideas, at least, you know, to many, that they couldn't also be good Christians. That is kind of paradoxical to us. Hence, I was interested in looking into it further. One of the other things, and you won't be able to read this yet, but I'll read it for us. One of the other things that clerics had to deal with in this trends to violence as well is this question of the world. In my classes, we talk a lot about the paradoxical nature of the fact that the Christian church is a spiritual organization that must exist in a secular world and has to interact with, you know, people, with kind of flawed individuals and so forth. So throughout the book, for those of you who have read it or are planning to read it, you will see that one of the things I talk a lot about is this concept of worldliness, that these clerics who are violent are often accused of being worldly, that they're more interested in the things of the flesh rather than the things of the spirit. And so I like to use this example. This is actually from about 600 or so. A Greek author, John Moschus, wrote a book called The Spiritual Meadow. And this is a little anecdote that he uses to talk about to essentially talk about the danger of falling into worldly desires. He says, "There was a holy man living in the Egyptian desert who had 10 disciples. One of them was very lazy and had no care for his own salvation. The elder admonished him often with stories of eternal punishment, but the brother didn't listen." These are monks that they're talking about. "Finally, he died, and the elder was deeply troubled and wept for him, fearing that he had gone to hell. So the elder prayed, 'Lord Jesus Christ, our true God, reveal to me the state of this brother's soul.' And he went into a trance, and he saw a river of fire with a multitude of people in it, and the poor brother was submerged up to his neck in the fire. And the elder wept and said, 'Didn't I tell you?'" And because you never want to miss an opportunity to say, "I was right, told you so." "And the brother answered, 'It's not so bad, Father. Because of your prayers for me, at least, my head is out of the fire, because I'm standing on the shoulders of a bishop.'" Which, wonderful, I love it. Yeah, John of Moschus was a sarcastic, you know what. But you're right, he's making a very important point here, that, you know, monks are at least holier than bishops, and they're holier than bishops because bishops almost can't avoid the world, right? That's their job, they have to be out there. And, you know, again, if you take a look through the book, you'll see that one of the basic responsibilities of bishops is these guys are major, major landholders. They owe responsibilities to the king, to the duke, to whomever. You know, land owes taxes, land owes soldiers, and those expectations don't just go away because the land is held by the church. So it's really hard for bishops to kind of avoid that kind of service. And, you know, Moschus is sort of poking fun at them for that reality. Okay, I do talk a little bit about the Crusades, but I'm not a Crusade historian, so I sort of dodge it a fair bit. But I should mention that in the section in which we talk about the Crusades, and just in talking about them in general, or the Templars or something like that, you know, warrior monks or whatever, I think what it shows us in the context of the overall kind of phenomenon is that the Crusades were a great opportunity for clerics to basically demonstrate a laudable purpose in violence. I think if there's a takeaway from the book, a basic conclusion, is that we as people are reasonably forgiving of actions that we think have a laudable outcome. We don't want to necessarily admit to being Machiavellian. We don't want to admit that, you know, the ends justify the means, but at least from the evidence of the Middle Ages, we're somewhat more open to it. And we saw that with William of Newburgh's example, right? We don't necessarily like the fact that the bishop is out there throwing axes at another bishop, but he's doing it for a good purpose. He's doing it to protect his flock, and therefore we kind of forgive him for that. And the Crusades are kind of a good example of that. You know, it's licit war, meaning very few people argue that the Crusades aren't legal, at least in Christendom. And so if a cleric is out there fighting, and he's doing it for Christ, he's doing it for his king, those are two areas where, you know, you could probably see some praise coming the bishop's way, and we'll see an example of that in a couple of minutes. Finally, I look at imaginative literature, and or chivalric literature. And again, those of you who have taken my classes, you know that, yeah, Courtney's looking at me, I use a significant amount of literature. And because I'm interested in cultural history, and the imagination that these folks impart through their literature is really one of the best ways of actually getting a sense of what they actually thought. Now, they don't necessarily think any of this is true, don't misunderstand me, but in a lot of ways, this is kind of the ideal vision of medieval society that you would be getting, at least for the elites. So Archbishop Turpin, who is one of the most famous characters from the Song of Roland, the Song of Aspremont, and a few other sort of epic cycles in the Middle Ages, he's kind of the best example of what knights sort of thought clerics could be, at least in a chivalric context, though it's not quite as simple as all that. And this is, we'll skip over that actually. We'll just get right to the, we'll go right to the literature because it's a bit more entertaining. So when you start reading these chivalric tales, you realize that at least with the context of Turpin, he is a better knight than most of the guys on the field. In fact, in the Song of Roland, I guess it's not really a spoiler because it's been out 1,000 years, when they all die, he is the second to last Christian knight, he's like the second to last Christian knight to be left on the field. It's him and Roland. And he's the second to last knight because he's one of the best warriors in the army. And so this is a good example of him basically fighting a Saracen and killing him, and it's all very gory and bloody and so forth. This is what Roland and Oliver, who is Roland's best friend, have to say about it. The two lays. The first one says, "And the archbishop killed Silgarel, the sorcerer who was once in hell. Jupiter led him there by sorcery." They didn't really understand Islam particularly well. They didn't know what the hell was going on with it. But anyway, Turpin said, "This one did us wrong." Roland replies, seemingly in response to Turpin killing the Muslim, "This scoundrel is vanquished. Oliver, comrade, such blows are worthy in my eyes." And then Roland says to Oliver, "The archbishop is a very good knight, bon chevalier, very good knight. There is no finer one on the face of the earth. He is formidable with lance and spear." Further, the poet tells us, "Archbishop Turpin goes through the battlefield. No tonsured person," which means cleric, "whoever sang mass was personally responsible for so many meritorious deeds." I mean, think about that for a second. If you read the story, almost every lay is basically him shoving his lance through somebody's head or chest or both, which is impressive, and killing them. And the poet is telling you, literally no other cleric ever did anything as good as this. This is fantastic stuff. He said to the pagan, "God rain misfortunes on you. You're killing this man, Ancias, cuts me to the heart." And he made his good horse lunge forward, and he struck the pagan on his shield, made in Toledo, and throwing him dead onto the green grass. Toledo's in Spain, not Ohio in this context. A little bit later on in the Song of Aspermall, which is a late 12th century story, it's in some ways even more amazing than the Roland story. In the Roland story, and the Roland story dates probably from about 1100 in the version we've got. He's just a knight. I mean, he's ridiculous. He kills people left and right, and he says mass and so forth. It's fantastic. In this one, he actually is asked to carry the true cross into battle. And the Pope, who is the foil for Turpin, the Pope is shown to be kind of a bad type of cleric because he's not willing to go into battle in many ways. He's trying to get people to carry the cross, and Turpin finally says to him, "Milon, my lord, pray do not be annoyed. I would give back this holy cross of yours, for I have a hauberk, which is armor, and a good horse of war, a bright steel helm at my side, and a sword. I am an archbishop and a knight withal. I would now show the worth of my employ. So I don't want to carry the true cross into battle because it will get in the way of me holding my lance and sword, because I am both an archbishop and a knight." Again, this is literature. This is not real life necessarily, except in some contexts, you know, it is. And if we had more time, we can talk about that at the end. This is sort of, like I said, this is ideal. This is one part of a debate. This is one part of what some people believe they want out of their clerics. And in the book, I show more and more examples, even guys like Henry II, the King of England, who is complaining that clerics are always telling us to go on crusade, but that's mostly because they know that they're not going to be the ones getting shot at, and so forth, right? That there's this sort of hostility and resentment among the knights that clerics talk a big game about what it means to go die for Christ, but we, the knights, are the ones doing it. So in their imagination, they have clerics who are willing to get out there as well and do it, even though canon law says, you know, stay off the battlefield. Okay, so that's all theoretical, more or less. Sorry, just having some coffee. Let's talk about some actual examples, and we'll run through these, and then we'll answer some questions. The royal we. First one that I look at, because I start in 1000, that's true, but most of these examples start in 1066 with Odo of Bayeux. This is an image of the Bayeux tapestry. It also adorns the book, because I couldn't really think of a cleric of the Middle Ages who was probably a better example of a warrior cleric than Odo, and also that we actually have an image of actually doing something, though we can argue about what he's actually doing here. Odo is a very, very interesting character. First off, he's Norman, So he's from the north of France. He is the half-brother to William I, William Duke of Normandy, also known as William the Bastard, and also then eventually known as William the Conqueror when he takes England. So when his brother essentially invades England in October of 1066, Odo is his right-hand man. And this is from the bio tapestry. If you look at the whole bio tapestry, Odo is in it again and again and again, usually sitting at his brother's right hand with his other brother, who is the Count of Mortain, sitting off to the other side. In the tapestry here, what he's doing is he's actually rallying the troops. There's a period in the battle where they think William has died, and they think he's been killed. And so the Norman troops, you can see them going the other way, you know. These guys here, battles that way. And here comes Odo wearing his clerical vestments, but beneath the vestments, you can just see at the ends, chainmail. He's wearing armor under his vestments and holding his, what the Latin is baculum, essentially, which means staff or mace. Long, heavy, solid piece of wood. And many historians have argued at great length whether or not this was a weapon or whether this was a symbol of office or what have you. I get a little into that in the book, but frankly, I don't care. It doesn't matter what it was, because I'm pretty sure if you hit somebody with it from the back of a horse, they're gonna die, or something horrible is going to happen to them. So he is in the midst of battle, he's wearing armor, he's holding a weapon, he's rallying the troops. This guy is a general. He's clearly comfortable on the battlefield. As it turns out, William doesn't die. And so Odo, he rallies the troops, and then they go off and they kill the English, and the Normans take over. So after the Battle of Hastings, when Harold Godwinson is killed, Odo becomes, he continues to be essentially the right-hand man of the king. So because now you have the Duke of Normandy serving as the King of England, which causes merry mischief for the King of France, because the Duke of Normandy is the King of France's vassal, but he's also the King of England, who's his rival. It gets confusing and wars happen. He has to go back to Normandy a lot. And so while he's in Normandy, he needs somebody he can trust to basically run England. That's Odo. Odo serves as justiciar, and not only him, usually a couple of noblemen will get together and serve as justiciar. So for most of the late 1060s and into the 1070s, Odo is found again and again and again in the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, in the Norman records, essentially administering the government, but also leading armies as necessary. When there are rebellions, Odo is the one out there. When the Bishop of Durham is murdered by the Northumbrians, Odo puts together an army and obliterates the North, and called the harrying of the North. He destroys it. He just goes up there and kills thousands of people in response to this. In the mid-1070s, when there's a rebellion, he's out there again leading armies. I mean, this is just part of his life. He's also the Earl of Kent, so he's one of the most powerful noblemen in England. As you can see here, he also gets arrested by his brother. His brother liked him a great deal, but when Odo decided that he was going to put together an army and go conquer Rome so he'd become pope, his brother thought he might have become a little bit too much trouble than he was worth, so he put him in jail. He finally gets released in the late 1080s when his brother dies and his nephew becomes king. And he goes over to Normandy and he starts serving the Duke of Normandy, his other nephew. And in the sources, what you find with Odo is right up to the end of his life when he dies as a crusader in 1095, having taken the cross after Pope Urban had preached at Clermont. He's constantly telling his nephew, the Duke of Normandy, to basically show a little backbone, because his nephew's he's fairly useless. He pretty much loses every war he fights, which is why he ends up dying in prison for about 30 years, that his other brother puts him. It doesn't matter. Anyway, so he's constantly telling his nephew, you need to show some spirit, you need to show some steel, like literally, you need to get out there and teach people a lesson. So clearly, you know, guys like Odo, these are not shrinking violets. These are not turn the other cheek type clerics. He's very much a kill them and God will sort them out type cleric. Well, on the other hand, you have guys like St. Wulfstan of Worcester. I'm going to use one example from each chapter. I should have mentioned that. So chapter 4 is kind of Odo and a few of his friends. Chapter 5 is St. Wulfstan and a few other folks like Archbishop Lanfranc and Archbishop Anselm. Wulfstan of Worcester is kind of the example of a good cleric. He's a saint. Everybody likes Wulfstan. Very few people like Odo. Most people think Odo is He's kind of a scumbag. You know, he's a warrior bishop. He's not comfortable at the pulpit. We don't have any evidence of him like preaching or anything like that. Wolfston, on the other hand, is everybody loves him, right? When you actually look at what he does, you realize it's very much like that example from William of Newburgh. It's not so much that he's staying out of politics, and quite the contrary. As far back as the 1060s, when he becomes a bishop, he is tapped by then King Edward the Confessor, and then eventually King Harold Godwinson, to basically go make peace for him in the realm. When William invades and wins, Wolfston then becomes one of his kind of right-hand men. In fact, what you'll find is you usually would find Wolfston defending Worcester. In 1075, for instance, during the same rebellion that Odo was off leading troops and beating people up, so is Wolfston. Wolfston's on the other side of the Severn. He's over there rallying troops in the west, preventing the nobles, who the Earl of Norfolk, who was leading them, from essentially linking up with each other. He's doing the same things, more or less, that Odo is doing, and yet he's a good guy. Odo's a bad guy. In some ways, the reason for that is what we saw here, right? That one of the other things I point out in the book is that the way you act, even if you're doing the same things, matters. Odo is out there becoming an earl. He's out there essentially taking on the trappings of knighthood. He's becoming worldly. He's becoming, you know, if you looked at his seal, one side of it was him as a bishop and the other side of it was him on a horse with a sword. And people thought that was gratuitous. That was bad. Wolfston never forgets that he is a cleric. So he can lead armies and he can do so in a way that does not essentially transgress his clerical identity. And then finally he dies and is sainted fairly soon afterwards. Well, in the middle part of the 12th century, we get to someone who sort of dances the line between what Odo was doing and what Wolfston was doing. This is Henry of Blois. Henry is, he's sort of an Odo figure in that he is comes from a very, very good lineage. His grandfather is William I. William I had three sons, none of whom got along, and one daughter whom he married off to the Count of Blois. And it's through her that we get Henry. So he has a claim to the throne. When Henry I dies in 1135 in England, Henry of Blois' brother, Stephen, excuse me, becomes king. At the time, Henry of Blois is the abbot of Glastonbury, which is a fairly major abbey down in the southwest, the supposed burial place of King Arthur. And he's also the Bishop of Winchester. Winchester is the closest thing England has to a capital at this time. It's where the royal treasury is, and it's the old Anglo-Saxon sort of capital of England. So he's an incredibly powerful guy. When his brother becomes king, Henry essentially becomes the most powerful clerical figure in the kingdom. So much so that he actually becomes the Pope's legate, the Pope's ambassador in England for 4 years. Usually that's held by the Archbishop of Canterbury, but for 4 years in the late 1130s and early 1140s, it's actually held by Henry of Blois. And when you start reading, there's lots and lots of stories of King Stephen's reign, mostly because he spends most of his reign fighting his cousin Matilda, who is Henry I's daughter. It's called the Anarchy, because they're basically going to war all the time for about 20 years. He is consistently in the thick of it, usually alongside his brother, the king, not always. Once when his brother basically arrested some bishops, he threatened to excommunicate him, and it was ugly, but they patched it up, and then Stephen got captured, and it's a very complicated story, but consistently Henry is part of this sort of narrative, that he's always in the thick of it, he's always leading troops, and sometimes getting criticized, but in the same breath getting praised. And this is one of the things that really intrigued me when I was reading it, where the same author would say, oh, it's terrible that Henry of Winchester and other bishops like him are wearing armor and going around like pillagers and leading troops and contributing to the bloodshed. And then a few pages later, it would be, ah, there was this horrible man over in Winchester who was fighting, and luckily good brave Bishop Henry stood up to him and put together an army and killed him. And you realize, okay, consistency is gonna be a problem here. But Henry is a great example, and he dies one of the most revered figures of the English church. Possibly not quite as well known as Richard Burton over here, who also known as Thomas Becket. Becket is probably one of the most well-known figures in the 12th century English church. But most people probably don't realize that he was a general as well. Now, Beckett is a great example of, in some ways, the other side of the argument, because Beckett serves as a general when he's a chancellor. He's still a cleric. He's still a priest. And actually, I think they make light of this in the 1964 Richard Burton film when Henry says to him, Peter O'Toole, you know, as Henry II says to him, "Well, aren't you, you know, priest of such and such?" And Dick Burton says, "Oh yes, I'd forgotten that. I'd forgotten you made me a priest," right? And that was meant to be amusing, that he was really only a cleric in name only, but once he became Archbishop of Canterbury, he sort of put all of that aside, and it's kind of a Saul Paul moment, right? The road to Damascus. He's going to put aside the things of the world, take on the things of the spirit, and he eventually gets martyred for standing up for ecclesiastical liberties. And that's how most of his biographers portray it. They say, yes, you know, prior to being archbishop, he would do things for the king, and it was nasty, and we weren't really happy about it. But then he became archbishop, and he became a saint. Well, that's the narrative that most of them give us, except one. One of his biographers actually decides that the stuff that he did as chancellor was really important. Because yes, it was violent, but he was doing it for the king. And it wasn't as good as what he did as archbishop, but it wasn't bad. Serving the king and seeking to bring the king's interest to the fore and all of that, it's not as good as serving Christ, but it's not something to be condemned either. So in the narrative of Beckett, you get this kind of inklings of the debate that we don't want to necessarily see it as black and white. Maybe there's opportunities for gray areas here. And maybe Beckett's pre-archiepiscopal life should not be condemned. And you know, there might be some value to it. All right, two more. I promise, more or less. Hubert Walter. Probably not a figure most people know, I imagine. But in the late 12th century, he was the going thing. Everyone knew who this guy was in England. He was the Bishop of Salisbury, which is a reasonably big diocese. He then becomes Archbishop of Canterbury, and he's important for us because he's a great, this is from chapter 8, he's a great example of a crusader knight or a crusader bishop. He goes with Richard the Lionheart on the Third Crusade, and when you start reading about what he does when he gets there, he and the Archbishop of Canterbury, a fellow by the name of Baldwin, when he dies, that's when Hubert Walter takes over as Archbishop, they essentially organize the Christian camp. It is consistently mentioned that they are out there rallying the troops and that they are a real strong contingent of the English army. That without them, you know, the English army wouldn't have been nearly as effective. And it's actually his actions on crusade that get Richard the Lionheart to say, hey, you'd be a great archbishop. So he gets him promoted to be the archbishop. He comes back to England, and while Richard is languishing in prison, on his whole other story, if you've watched the Robin Hood movies, you know it. This is the guy who's in England fighting Prince John. He's over there basically representing Richard's interests, leading armies, and you know, when Richard comes back, he essentially continues doing it. Most people don't have necessarily a problem with this, but there are certainly some concerns. I'll show you two examples. This is praise that he gets when he is on crusade. From the Itinerarium Peregrinorum et Gesta Regis Ricardi, which is basically the itinerary of the pilgrimage of and the deeds of King Richard. The clergy, however, claimed no small part of the military glory, for the abbots and prelates led their cohorts and they boldly fought for the faith, joyfully striving for the law of God. The stout-hearted Bishop of Salisbury could not bear to absent himself from the expedition, but distinguished himself in the battle. And this is one of the most famous examples and descriptions. He did what a soldier should in the field, a leader in the camp, and a pastor in the church. I mean, that could have come right out of the Song of Roland, where he does what is necessary in the context of where he is. So when he's on the field, he is the greatest soldier there. When he's in the camp, he's the greatest leader there. And when he's in the church, he's the greatest pastor there. Richard de Templo has no problem with that. He thinks that's good. I mean, that's a laudatory sort of thing. This is what you should be doing as a cleric. Not everybody is a fan. This is Gerald of Wales. Gerald of Wales, I do point out at the end, he's being sarcastic. So he says, "Blessed be God, who has taught your hands, he's talking about Hubert Walter, who has taught your hands to war and your fingers to fight. Blessed be God, who by the hand of his anointed has given such a glorious victory over the enemy. And blessed be his holy name, who has ordained that this great realm should be ruled by law and pacified by arms through the unwearied labor of his pontiff and primate, strong both in spiritual and worldly warfare, fighting with either sword and by his marvelous skill, molding himself to meet the vicissitudes of these times. He is, again, this is sarcasm. He's basically trying to channel the Sermon on the Mount to an extent and say, your hands are dirtier than a common soldier's. On the other hand, he does recognize, in retrospect, that nevertheless, he was a restraint upon the king and an obstacle to tyranny. This is what happens when you have King John. He was the peace and solace of the people, and in his day, the refuge in need of rich and poor alike against the oppressions of the government, as is evident from what has happened since. For no sooner was he dead than tyranny grew stronger in the realm, and as though a barrier had been broken down, a more shameless and unwise arrogance has raged in both secular and religious affairs. So even Gerald of Wales, who would be one of his critics, is saying, okay, I might not have liked the guy, but apparently in retrospect, the alternative was worse, because the alternative was King John. So folks can read this and say, okay, maybe there's a place for this kind of strong-armed Christianity, I suppose. All right, final example. Peter de Rocher. Peter de Rocher, as you can see, dies in 1238, so he's the last figure I really talk about. He is the Bishop of Winchester. Again, Winchester, one of the most important sees or dioceses in England. He leads troops during the war when the French had invaded England and actually taken London in 1216, 1217. This is when Henry III is very, very young. John has died, Magna Carta has failed, and Prince Louis is sitting in London, basically wondering when the rest of England's gonna show up and crown him king of the English. So de Rocher is one of the great warriors on behalf of Henry III. He eventually kind of gets self-imposed exile later on and goes off on crusade with Frederick II and essentially ends his life leading papal armies. The Pope invited him down to Rome because he was a great warrior. So when we look at the history of William Marshall, which is one of the great sources for this period, William Marshall was the regent of England at the time. This is what they have to say about Peter de Rocher's actions. Again, he's a bishop, right? The worthy Bishop of Winchester, Peter de Rocher, who was in charge that day of advising our side, was not slow or slothful, and he knew how to make use of his arms. In the company of his fine troop of men, he gave chase, and in the course of that pursuit, he did very well indeed, capturing knights as he went. His men, bent on making gains, made many. At other times in the history of William Marshall, they say of Peter de Rocher that he was put in charge of the crossbowmen because he had a special knowledge of that weapon, and that's really good. It helped us win the battle, even though the use of the crossbow had been literally outlawed by the church, you know, 40 years earlier. That didn't seem to matter. And there's a wonderful scene of him earlier on when Marshall charges into battle. Peter de Rocher, who had been trying to tell him to hold off, charges right behind him, brandishing his sword, yelling, you know, charge, God is with the marshal, let's go. And again, it's just a wonderful insight into these sort of competing ideas that we can talk about in just a second. I finish with looking at the 13th century and sort of going beyond. This is much, much later. This is about 1500 or so from Erasmus. At least we think it's from Erasmus. And in the early 1500s, I use this as the final example just to say that this question doesn't go away, right? What are clerics supposed to do? And I won't necessarily read this whole thing, but this is from a woodcut called The Exclusion of Julius from Heaven. Julius was the Pope. And Erasmus, who was known for his wonderful kind of sarcasm, wrote, what would happen if Julius had died and gone to heaven? And as you can see, Julius here is wearing armor with a PM on it, Pontifex Maximus, High Priest, or Pontiff. And he's wearing the papal crown, and he's holding the papal, essentially, banner. He's got a papal bull here, like an indulgence, which was the big thing at the time. Luther got very annoyed about these. And he's holding one of the keys supposedly given to him by Peter, which was always the Pope's argument. Behind him, of course, is an army of men with halberds and muskets. And standing behind the door, blatantly not planning to let him in, is St. Peter. And as you read the dialogue, you realize that, at least in Erasmus's mind, had the Pope who claimed to speak for St. Peter actually met St. Peter, St. Peter would have thought him the worst thing ever, would have thought him, you know, this horrible kind of blood-soaked, as he says here, you know, gunpowder-reeking, prostitute-reeking scumbag, essentially, and that this had given lie to the whole idea of what the medieval church was representing. So I don't go too far into this, obviously. This is kind of a very late example just to show where the debate goes. But over the course of the book, you know, essentially what I think I'm able to show by looking at the evidence is that the question is very open, that the debate is very real. The reason I came to this originally is because I was actually writing a different topic for my dissertation for the PhD, and I was writing about urban militias, very exciting. And a lot of these cities were run by bishops, so I thought, oh, I need a book on bishops, you know, militias, and I couldn't find one. But all I kept finding were modern historians essentially saying about these bishops who would get involved in war, well, you know, sometimes he'd end up on the battlefield, but he really wasn't supposed to, and nobody was really happy about it, but hey, what are you gonna do? Some of these guys were throwbacks. And then I started reading the primary sources, and I realized, I don't think that's what they're saying at all. I think it makes us feel better, as modern Christians, that we would never valorize guys like this, right? No, these are the bad guys. We would never valorize men who charged into battle and, you know, splattered people's brains with a mace, because that's not, you know, that's not what Christianity is. And it's probably not what Christianity is, I suppose, these days, but part of the argument is that, to an extent, it's what, you know, certainly Christianity was, that the idea that you should charge into battle, that you should lay your life down for the flock, was never really a majority idea. You know, the canon law consistently said this was bad, but they kept doing it, and then they weren't treated as, you know, criminals necessarily. They weren't treated as pariahs, and in fact, many of them were praised and lauded, you know, for many years, and frankly, some of them became saints. So, on that cheerful idea, I'll go ahead and stop and answer whatever questions have arisen. Obviously, you all have many, I'm sure. So, I'm happy to address them. So, thank you. Questions? Anyone? Yeah, you don't have to applaud. It's okay, Drew. I thought about it. I like you thought about it, though. Yes, ma'am.
I know that you said that you were not a student of the Crusades, but can you tell us a little bit about the thinking back at that time?
Sure.
Why Europe went on the Crusades? And if you think it was justified?
Okay. I'm a trifle deaf in this ear. I didn't hear that last part. The thinking behind the Crusades. The Crusades are kind of an interesting phenomenon. When you look at the early, essentially, calls to the Crusades, guys like Urban at Clermont in 1088, what he focuses on is the idea that Christianity is under threat. That with the rise of the Seljuk Turks over in the Middle East, that now Christian pilgrims can't go to Jerusalem anymore. He talks a lot about outrages that supposedly happened, various things that had happened to Christian pilgrims. And there was this very messianic sort of idea to Christianity, that if you weren't spreading Christianity, you weren't doing it right. And one of the examples of that is, if the holiest site of Christianity is not in the hands of Christians, then clearly we have failed as Christians, that, you know, we have failed God, we've allowed, as they would say, the infidel to take hold. And so now, with these latest outrages, we should go ahead and send some troops out to the east to deal with this. And now, one thing I should mention is that part of the reason Urban II, who's the Pope, does this is because the Byzantine Emperor had sent him a letter saying, hey, my army just got obliterated in 1071, I could use some European knights to serve as essentially mercenaries. Could you send me some? And so when Urban preaches this, he doesn't necessarily expect that, you know, 20,000 knights are all going to get together and go march off to the Holy Land under their own leaders, and it turns out to be a whole mess. But from the perspective of the guys doing it, you know, Jonathan Riley Smith, one of the great Crusade historians who just died, I think, maybe a year or so ago, he always argued that the appeal of Crusade was that it unified two things that that most people believed in the Middle Ages. One was that you could expiate sin through suffering, and you could expiate sin through pilgrimage. So going on pilgrimage, showing that you were willing to essentially walk barefoot to Jerusalem or whatnot, was a good expiation of your sin. On top of that, fighting for the faith, fighting to protect Christ. That was had been for many, many years, well before the Crusades. That was accepted as pretty good too. You can get, you know, letters from bishops going all the way back into the 500s and before, saying if you die fighting the enemies of Christ, you will go to heaven. And so in Riley Smith's mind, and I think this is fairly true for most Crusade historians, what the Crusade did is it basically brought those two things together. It said, you can go on crusade, you can go on pilgrimage to Jerusalem, and along the way, you can wage holy war to secure the path for those to come behind you. And they can go on crusade, or they can go on pilgrimage as well. In fact, in the early Crusade literature, going on crusade, the word they used was peregrinatio, was pilgrimage. I mean, that's what they thought they were doing. They were just taking a sword with them. I will leave the idea of whether they were justified to another time. Because, you know, it's hard to say. I will say this. They thought they were. They definitely thought they were. Now, later on in the 12th century, there was argument. After the failure of the Second Crusade, you know, because this was, if you live by divine will, you die by divine will. So the First Crusade worked. So clearly, God is a Christian. The Second Crusade failed. That led to awkward silence and questions in medieval Europe. So there were some who complained about it and said, you know, maybe these Crusades are no longer, you know, we no longer have God's approval. Oh, actually, that brings up a, I'll forget it, I don't have time to talk about it. But yeah, so that's essentially where the Crusades came from. Yeah, in this context, I use them because most people considered them to be licit warfare. That you know, as we saw with the example from William of Newburgh, you know, fighting for your own gain, fighting to, you know, cause violence for no reason beyond plunder, that was illicit warfare. And so if you were doing that, you were going to get criticized, like Bishop Wiemond. Whereas fighting in licit causes, fighting to defend the flock, fighting to defend your king, fighting to bring peace, fighting on crusade, you had a lot more leeway to do that. And so that's where I talk about the Crusades, though I heartily try to dodge most of the Crusade historiography as much as I can. Yes, Courtney. Oh, 1,000 to 1,250? I initially thought of doing 1066 to 1240, and that was literally just because of the people I was writing about. So if you start with Odo of Bayeux and you go through Peter de Rocher, that's essentially that time period. But the reason I liked it was because, hold on, next one. The reason I like that time period in particular was it occupies kind of a sweet spot of debate in medieval Christianity. 1000 is you start seeing canonical collections being issued a lot more, whether these are from Burkhard of Worms or Ivo of Chartres or a few others. You know, people are trying to compile the canon law and they're trying to say, hey, we need a law of Christianity. And these really start taking off around about 1000. By the time you get to 1250, that had already been established. And so there were a lot of canonical collections out there, and a lot of them were considered fairly complete. And then you get into all these arguments about, you know, how many angels can dance on the head of pins and whatnot. So I thought, I'm not going to get into those arguments. I'm mostly interested in this period where things are still in flux, where there's still a kind of debate over what people should be doing. And once they get really codified, I'm not quite as interested, I guess. I'm a medievalist. I try to avoid evidence if I can. Other questions?
I've got a question.
Yes, ma'am.
What made you interested in this particular subject?
Sure. part of it is I'm a contrarian, and my colleagues can certainly attest to that reality. That one of the things that drew me to this is that most people never really considered the role that bishops played in warfare, and if they did, they did it from a very prescriptive kind of normative perspective that, like I said earlier, you know, bishops really shouldn't be on the battlefield, and if they were, you know, nobody was really happy about it, and they were essentially just criminals. And I thought to myself, that doesn't seem right. I don't think that's actually what the evidence is showing us. So, like I said, I was initially interested in it by just that finding this kind of emptiness in the historiography, that there wasn't a book about warrior bishops in the Middle Ages. I wanted to read one for my other research, and then I found that there wasn't one, and so I found it interesting. But even before this, I'd always been interested in the characters in medieval history who not so much weren't necessarily talked about. I mean, these guys were all talked about, but I was never all that interested in the narratives that had already been written about them. So before this, one of the things I worked on was, because I've always been interested in warfare and culture, I worked on the role that, you know, non-noble soldiers played in warfare, because no one ever really wrote about them. And I thought, well, that's interesting. I'm not no one, but you know, they were never focused on. So I thought, hey, let's try to shed some light on them. Same with this, you know, let's try to shed some light on not just what these bishops are doing in battle, but what the actual debate about it was, because it was something that never was really treated very effectively. At least I didn't think so. So we'll see what my reviewers think, I guess. But any other questions? Yes, Ben Newman. Motivation is tough in history, because one of the things that I didn't really talk about that's actually, you know, quite important about this is, I gotta think about this, make sure I get it right. None of these bishops ever tell us why they did it. We don't have, you know, letters home from the front to their friends saying, I'm so glad to be here doing this. We don't have that. I mean, they just didn't keep this. They're all very learned men. They're all very famous men. We have letters from many of them, but they don't really talk too much about this. There are some examples. In chapter 5, Archbishop Len Frank, who's a not a saint, but he's a saintly-ish kind of figure, he writes a series of letters to the king, who's William I, during the 1075 rebellion. And he's basically updating the king on what's happening with these wars. And in one of them, because he's leading the army, the archbishop is, he's leading the army against one of the traitors. He tells the king, you know, don't come home yet, because it would be a grave insult to my honor if you came home before I was able to squash these rebel scum. And that gives you, I think, a little bit of an insight into who these guys were. I mean, they are coming from, for the most part, the higher nobility, right? These are not peasants who are becoming the archbishops of Canterbury. And even if they are, once they become the archbishop of Canterbury, they're sitting at the high table, all right? They get nobilized pretty quick. So I think you can see in their insight some of the same sorts of virtue signaling that you would have found from the secular nobility. These guys care deeply about honor. They care deeply about loyalty. They care deeply about service. I mean, they really do. These folks thought of themselves as shepherds, and like shepherds lay down their lives for the flock. So, you know, they're like, but again, finding that motivation is hard because they don't ever bother to tell us. So we have to try to reconstruct it as best we can. I got into trouble once at a conference for speculating on the motivation of crusaders. That went badly. So I will try to avoid that here. Yes, sir.
The popes weighed in.
Yes, the popes weighed in. The popes weighed in a fair bit. For these figures, not surprisingly, when you look at somebody like Odo of Bayeux, who is this figure here, arresting a bishop was usually considered an unlawful act, and the Pope would get angry with you. So if you were the king and you put a bishop in jail, the Pope would, you know, protest. We don't have too much protest when Odo of Bayeux gets put in jail. And some people have speculated that's because he was a warrior bishop. I speculate it's because he was trying to conquer the papacy. I don't think the Pope was terribly thrilled to trying to let this guy out of jail. But again and again, you find the popes getting involved, and what you find is kind of the same thing we find elsewhere. Good example is when we get to Henry of Blois. When Henry is the legate of the Pope, meaning he's the papal ambassador, his brother loses a battle, the Battle of Lincoln in 1141, the king, and he gets captured by his enemies. And the Pope sends angry letters to Henry of Blois saying, you need to get your brother out of jail by any means necessary, spiritual or secular. So no excuses. Excommunicate people and raise an army if you have to. Later on, when we're dealing with, not so much Becket, but I'm going to look at Dick Burton for a while. Later on, when we're dealing with some other warrior bishops, if the Pope was very much against them, he wouldn't raise a finger to help them. One good example is a bishop by the name of Philip of Dreux. He's actually French, but I talk about him anyway. He is the Bishop of Beauvais. He gets himself captured in battle against the English, and he appeals to the Pope, essentially saying, hey, get me out of here. I was serving my king, who was also his brother, the King of France. And the Pope says, you know, supposedly holding up his bloody armor, this is from an English source, says, you're no son of mine, and he drops it and he leaves him in jail. But as soon as that Pope dies, and Innocent III becomes Pope, one of his first acts is to basically write the King of England and say, you let Philip of Dreux out of jail right now. You know, we need him. He's one of ours. And then finally, you know, with somebody like Peter de Rocher, he's invited by the Pope. This is, I think, who was it? I can't remember which Pope it was in the 1230s. But one of the great canonists, he actually oversees the creation of Liber Extra, which is the sort of like major canonical collection. He invites Peter de Rocher to come and be a papal general and say, you know, lead my armies against the Holy Roman Empire, and you know, go out here and show me some of that secular prowess that I've heard so much about. And this is the guy who's literally publishing the laws saying clerics shouldn't be involved in warfare. So, like anything, it's debatable. Other questions? Fantastic. All right, well, there's more food, as far as I know. Bonnie is nodding, yes, there's more food. If you've not had a chance to sign in, please do so. I appreciate that, yeah. You may applaud now, it's okay, thank you. I'm sorry, Kyle, go ahead. Please.